Hey everyone, it's O&A Detox time!
Time!
Once again, it's Devin Muse, back again, talking that shit about the boys you love to hate.
The boy you love to hate and the boy who lived.
Oh! Yeah.
Didn't get dragged down.
That is
Voldemort.
True. And what are Anthony's horcruxes? Just World War II Nazi memorabilia?
Horcruxes are his childhood.
Oh.
Women and people dying.
Having to visit elderly relatives?
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'd say the first horcrux would be the small puppet that he used to play with that his dad thought was a doll, so he wouldn't let him play with it because, you know.
That's a very good specific one, yeah.
Yeah.
If you think about it, if you think about the genius that is Voldemort, he, like, had things that he liked. Then those things that he liked were there when he, like, lost a piece of himself. Genius.
Genius writing?
/ S.
And then I'll say the final horcrux is his fucking table mic. Anthony pounds the table so much when he talks. And he used to do that back in the old days, too. Then why would you then put a microphone on the table? It sounds so bad. Every time. So I don't have any compound media stuff this week, unfortunately. It's all back.
Oh, okay.
I know. It's funny. The one source I thought I had... I thought I found another YouTube page that posted videos and clips from Anthony's Compound Media show. And then I started to realize whenever a new one got posted, that it would be like 4 or 5 years old.
Oh.
I'm like, oh, this isn't even recent?
I guess they're scraping the bottom of the barrel, essentially.
Are they doing anything?
Yeah, they're like, are they doing any episodes?
It's what I'm worrying about.
What's-his-face supposed to be moving to South Carolina?
Anthony has been posting pictures from South Carolina. He posted a picture of a karaoke bar he went to.
He posted a picture of a crawdad catfish.
And people in the comments section were pointing out how there were no black people there. And actually, I'm going to read the tweet because I don't think we have any doubters at this point. But if anyone still wants to argue that Anthony is not a white supremacist... Well, actually, I just pulled this up. This is me live checking my Twitter. Stalker Patricia Brooks tweeted 4 hours ago, 3.5 miles paced in 47 minutes at a race in Brooklyn under New York Roadrunners. I'll take it. Still at it.
Wholesome.
Yes, very much so.
We love to see her succeed.
This isn't the tweet I was looking for. This is a video from the karaoke bar.
Oh, no.
And the caption says... People drinking, laughing, and having fun. No fights, no problems. Good people. You get so fucking cynical in New York City. And the video is a whole room full of white people drunkenly singing along to Rockstar by Nickelback.
Ew.
Oh. Hey, man, if that's what makes you happy, at least you found something. And it's not ranting about racism
maybe
and stuff on Twitter.
Maybe he'll start a Nickelback cover band in South Carolina.
Ooh! Yeah, the pictures of the room and the caption says, Dueling Piano Bar in Greenville. Pisser. Great people. And someone commented and said, Very bright in that room. Great choice of location. And Anthony quote tweeted it saying something about the, it's like... Yeah, you don't have to deal with that element here. I would argue that South Carolina is probably in the top 5 blackest states.
I think so, too.
I don't know. Like, if you found the corner of the state that happens to match
like,
what
Greenville,
you
want. Though? Like, it is, like...
Greenville's more hoity-toity, isn't it?
Yeah, Greenville's got a lot of hoity-toity shit. It's richer, so maybe gentrification's pushed a bunch of, like, low-income housing out, and thus pushed, like, black folks out. But there's still gonna be plenty of black folks in Greenville. South Carolina is number 4.
I knew it.
North Carolina is number 8.
Wow, holy shit.
It's Louisiana, Georgia, Maryland, South Carolina, Alabama, Delaware, North Carolina, Virginia. It's probably not so much about the demographic and more about housing costs.
That's true. And how much is he really going to be going out? Like, I'm very surprised he went to a fucking karaoke bar. Maybe that's something he likes to do. Maybe that's, you know, it's a blind spot on my part because I just don't care enough to hear about his personal things. But he sounds like a dude who just likes to stay in, plays video games, watches history documentaries, and drink.
Eat hot chip, lie.
We're now in the sunny summer months of July, and we're kicking off this episode with July 1st. For the past couple days, we've been hearing about the headache that Anthony's been having dealing with trying to get his backyard in order, mainly the pool he's trying to get finished. He's issued an ultimatum to the company working on his pool, saying that if construction wasn't finished by the end of the week, he'd shit-talk the company by name on air. I think he said something like, I'm gonna give you the worst fucking commercial of your life.
Oh.
Which, I mean, they have a pretty big audience, so that would be shitty. Construction was finished on time, regardless if the threat was a contributing motivator or not. Opie speculates he'll never be invited over to see the pool, when we learn some upcoming festivities being planned by the incomparable Antholini!
At the new pool?
I feel it's
been... Oh, they're having a pool party!
Gonna have a pool party.
Antholini's gonna have a pool party!
I feel like we haven't talked about or heard about Antholini in, like, 2 episodes.
Yeah, I didn't think they were still together.
Well, they are for a little bit.
I don't know.
Hey, I don't even think I'll ever be invited to a pool party.
Of course you are!
I don't think I'll be invited.
There's a big party that we are planning. Me and the lovely... Miss Nicolini,
yeah,
are planning a giant party for the end of July, and everybody's invited.
Oh, look at that!
Everybody,
are we going to be schmoozing with like news people?
Well, yeah, there could be some high end celebrities there.
I don't know about how high end exactly.
Yeah,
only a minor spoiler here. The party does not happen at the end of July; it does get pushed back
to like November.
I think it's the end of August.
Oh.
So they have to push it back an entire month.
I guess it's still hot then.
Sometimes the news the boys get isn't exactly new, which is the case with this story from last November. They just heard about a man named John Horn. The man from Houston, Texas, was the center of a murder trial after he shot 2 black men who were robbing his next-door neighbor's house. A crucial part of the case is the 911 call, where the dispatcher asks Horn 14 times to not leave his house and not attempt to stop the robbers.
Oh my God.
Why don't you listen to me carefully, okay?
Yes.
I've got officers coming out there. I don't want you to go outside that house. And I don't want you to have that gun in your hand when those officers are poking around over there.
Okay? I understand that, okay? Oh, yeah. But I have a right to protect myself too, sir, and
yes,
you understand
you
that.
Yes,
and the laws have been changed in this country since September the 1st, and you know it and I know it.
September the 1st?
I have a right to protect myself.
I'm right there.
And a shotgun is a legal weapon. It's not an illegal weapon.
No, it's not. I'm not saying that. I'm
all right.
Not wanting you to, you know, make
oh, baby, he's coming out the window right now. I gotta go, buddy. I'm sorry, but he's coming out the window.
Don't.
In ordinance to the Castle Doctrine,
Texas
is a stand-your-ground state where murder in self-defense is legal, so ultimately Horn was not charged with murder. Horn argued he shot in an act of self-defense, even though the men he killed were shot in the back. Critics speculated how differently things would have went if Horn were black and the robbers were white, seeing as how the jury was made up of all white people, which did not reflect the population of the county. Years later, a black man was charged with murder after he killed an intruder in his own home, but was not found guilty. He later cited John Horn as an example of the legal double standard, since Horn was not even defending his own property. I already read that Glenn Beck publicly defended Horn, though he did go on to say that property was not worth killing over. I can't help but be reminded of how Kyle Rittenhouse got away with murder and how the right-wing pundits continue to defend his actions.
Don't go out the door.
They just stole something. I'm going out the window.
Don't
I'm sorry.
Go
I ain't
going
to let them get away with it. They stole
go
something. They got a bag of
the
something.
House.
I'm doing it.
Mr. Do not
I'm
go
sorry.
Outside the house.
This ain't right, buddy.
You're going to get yourself shot if you go outside that house with a gun.
You want to make a
what
bet?
You think.
You want to make a bet? You want to make a bet? I'm willing to make a little wager with you that I ain't getting shot.
Yeah, this dude's a fucking on a power trip.
Oh, yeah.
And I can't help it, but I hate this voice. So I can't help but already be very mad at him.
I hate Joe Horn.
Joe Horn rules.
You know why I hate him? Because he's not being honest. He's not being honest.
He
wants to just kill two black dudes. He's not, if he was being honest about it, I'd be right with you, loving Joe Horn.
Yeah.
But he's using that little slick. He's like, he knows what he's doing, and he's leaving himself a little, trying to leave himself a little legal alibi. I hate Joe.
That's why this is a great story, man.
You know what?
It's a great story because I think Jimmy's right there. I mean,
lying.
He's got the excuse he was looking for.
Let me tell you something.
But he still rules for. I don't know why, but he just rules.
He can be completely wrong in this whole thing. This is absolutely not the way you handle it. If you're a gun owner, it's not responsible. I wouldn't handle a situation like this. But if he shoots these burglars, I could give a flying F. Good. Those guys are criminals, non-productive members of society. And in a great state like Texas, good for them. They got what they deserved, whether it's legal or not.
I'll only agree with you if they're guys who had like a violent history. If they're two, look, I don't want to get burglarized, obviously.
Yeah.
But if they're two guys who are stealing something to get high. I'm not saying it's right, and I'm not saying they shouldn't go to jail, but to have two guys get killed who are non-violent offenders like that, who
don't
have violent histories, I can't.
Someone was in the house? What if this? What if that? Who knows?
Were they armed, though?
Yeah, this dude fucking got out of his own house and chased them down to murder them.
Yeah, like, it's not even your own house, bro.
No.
You're not even house-sitting. That's not your property in any way, shape, or form. Get over it.
Yeah, like someone was trying to say, like, what if people were in the house and they were in danger? We don't know that, though.
Mm-hmm.
And he didn't know that. It actually sounded like Joe was saying that they weren't at home.
Like, on one hand, I am totally for communities protecting themselves.
Yeah.
On the other hand, that isn't what's happening here. What's happening here is just this old white guy looking for an excuse to shoot some black kids. Like,
it definitely seems like that.
Yeah, like...
The dispatcher is saying that the police should be out there soon. They weren't out there quickly enough for Joe.
Why are you calling the cops if you're going to try to defend it yourself?
That's a really good point.
Like...
Why don't I just fucking do it?
Why do you need the cops also?
And the dispatcher was making a very good point, because I think the cops were actually there, and they're probably waiting to see the people leaving the premises to get them.
Yeah.
But he was saying, like... If the cops see you with a fucking gun...
you've got a gun and there are cops coming.
Yeah, like, they could easily mistake. They could hurt you. Joe's extremely lucky that he, you know, that things worked out for him. That he was white. Yeah, exactly.
It's easier to see a white person than it is to see a black person if you're a cop.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so this is where Steve from Bayshore, who is just one of these fucking Kumia ball lickers, there's a handful of people who... We're instant feedback people from way back in the day that are still on Twitter, and they haven't grown up at all. And they were, like, in their 30s and 40s at the time, so now they're just middle-aged, 60-year-old, pathetic, racist old men.
Yeah, they're just boomers.
Yeah, they're Facebook dudes, but on Twitter. It's no different.
All right, here we go. I backed up the tape.
Steve from Bayshore, tell Jimmy to leave therapy or leave the show.
No.
Oh, God. It's sensitive Jim.
But no, it's not that. It's just this guy is making me sick because he's lying.
I love this guy.
He's lying.
True American hero.
I'm right down the middle on this one.
He's a boob.
I'm right down the middle. I agree with what Jimmy's trying to say, but for some reason, I just think he rules, though.
Here's what he is. He's a little fat face. Look at him. He's a little fat-faced old man who wants to feel virile and young and powerful. He's using this situation to do what he wants to do. He doesn't care about that dumb neighbor.
Yeah.
This is two episodes in a row we're doing where a caller calls up and argues with Jim for a long stretch of time, calling him, like, a liberal who has white guilt and all of this.
Oh, my God.
It's like, they don't call in a lot, but I have a feeling that it's that kind of people that do make up a pretty... the silent majority of ONA fans.
Yeah.
And it's unfortunate for a couple reasons that when you actually do get people who do call in, because they rant for so long, the calls take up such long stretches of time, they're not very good arguers. Jim actually is a pretty good arguer. He'll be able to throw shit back in your face. And it feels like such a waste of time.
They just think they're on the same level of, like, hosting.
Yeah.
You know?
I always wonder how much people back then didn't actually like Jimmy on the show.
Yeah, like, it's not like he's, like, some fucking leftist.
No, not really. Like, he's only liberal compared to Anthony.
Yeah.
And we don't really know where Opie stands because he's not very outspoken about his politics.
Mm-hmm.
Opie livestream I watched, he said he's never voted in anything in his entire life. Anthony says he votes all the time. Opie says he's never voted. He falls back on that one George Carlin bit.
If you vote and you elect dishonest, incompetent people, and they get into office and screw everything up, well, you are responsible for what they have done. You caused the problem. You voted them in. You have no right to complain. I, on the other hand...
Yeah, okay, it's fine as a joke, but Opie's, like, falling on it as a fucking life mantra. And an excuse. Well, I wiped my hands of the whole situation. I didn't have anything to do with this.
I didn't vote.
My own father apprehended somebody that was robbing a neighbor's house and held him at gunpoint until the police got there. Two guys.
Wow.
Yeah.
I'm surprised he didn't shoot.
And as he described it on the phone to me many years ago, he said, two... We're trying to rob a house next door.
And you wonder where you get it from.
He held them at gunpoint until the cops got there. And I think he actually told them, don't move or I'll shoot you.
That's wonderful.
Yeah, that tracks.
Yeah. I love Opie sitting there like, I wonder where you get it from. It's like, why are you even saying this?
Yeah, why do you need to say it?
It's so funny how racist my dad is. Anthony loves to present his dad as if his dad was more racist, and it's like, thank God I'm not that bad.
He presents his whole family like that, even like extended family.
Yeah, he was sitting there like, oh yeah, I was hanging out with my mom, my stepdad, and aunts and uncles, and boy, they were just throwing the N-word around.
Yeah, it's
just
like,
because you don't do it on air doesn't mean it's like
you love it.
Yeah, it's like, you probably think it's hilarious. Of course you don't have a problem with it.
Mm-hmm.
It's funny, Anthony doesn't cut racist or problematic people out of his family.
No.
But if you get sick and you're dying, you're never going to see Anthony again.
Doesn't matter how racist and bigoted you are, you're donezo. Anthony's never talking to you again.
More importantly, it doesn't matter how good of a relationship you had with Anthony during your entire lifetime. The second you get sick, you're not seeing him ever again. So CBS FM, classic. Classic rock station, 60s, 70s, big in New York. They just recently moved into the same building as the O&A show and is located mere feet from their studio in what used to be O&A's green room. I was never aware how close they were until the video I'm about to show you. This week, CBS is currently running down their catalog alphabetically. Promotions like this are pretty common around the 4th of July, as people are believed to be listening to the radios more at gatherings around the holiday. The Firecracker 500 is a pretty common bit where stations will count down the top 500 songs in some arbitrary countdown. It's like, ooh, what's going to be number one this year? Is it going to be Stairway to Heaven again? Is it going to be something from the Beatles? Like, it's always going to be something, but...
Stairway to Heaven again.
And who decides this? Did people vote on it? No, it's
they
just
they put it in one of those bingo things.
Ooh, like the Rumble.
Is that what's it called? Oh, no.
Yeah,
I thought you were saying it is called a Rumble. What is it called?
It's a Tumblr.
Tumblr, okay, yeah. It's a Rumbler.
It's a Rumbler. Yeah, it is now. So you can pick out between number 1 and 30 and see which is...
Who's your pick to win?
Except in the Rumble, it's like, oh, anybody could be 1 or 30. Except with the Firecracker 500, I very doubt that number 1 is going to be something like... I don't know... I'm trying to pick a semi-obscure classic rock song that might be in the 500 somewhere, but not in the top 10. I don't know, some Elton John deep cut. Something from an album after the original lead singer passed away.
Yeah.
This is the second incarnation of a band.
Mm-hmm.
And it's also pretty common because a lot of DJs take a lot of time off in the summer months. And especially around the 4th of July, so I guess they just figure... Hey, if we do this thing where we basically just play music the whole time, we could just have an intern. WNAW did something very similar in 1999 until O&A argued with management as it was too soon after the station's anniversary throwback bit that they refused to take part in. The evolution of the Rock of New York that we talked about where they were having to play songs from different years and they weren't able to play the new rock they were hired to play.
Yeah.
In the spirit of the season... The boys start trouble with CBS by having producer and future Compound Media contributor Erock troll the neighboring station.
They're doing A to Z. They started yesterday, and they're not going to end until, like, next Monday. 3,000 songs of.
And they already told us what the last song is going to be, Zorro the Greek.
Zorba the Greek.
Or Zorba the Greek. And Erock can't wait to do this. So now we want you to just knock on their door politely. Are they listening to us right now? Well, go, hey, Opie and Anthony want to know what song you're up to as you do your A to Z countdown.
Okay.
Is this what you hear me?
Yeah. I think they're going on air.
Dude, go. Yes.
You on the air?
Yeah, it's going to be a couple minutes.
Oh, okay. Opie and Anthony just wanted to know what song you're playing right now.
Playing Guns N' Roses.
What are you playing?
No, we're going to play Barry Manilow right now. Could it be the Magic?
Barry Manilow.
Wouldn't be the Magic.
Couldn't be the Magic?
Yeah.
Oh, who gives a crap?
that's not right. Oh, jeez.
Here you go, Erock. 20 bills. Lunch is on me today.
Oh, who gives a crap?
Yeah, they really are extremely close. I had no idea. Like, you basically just turn the corner and you're back in the studio.
Yeah, it almost seems like there's not even a hallway.
No.
Like, you just, like, you turn right and just bam.
Yeah, they seriously just took O&A's green room, which is just, you have people on the show, guests or whatever, they could just hang out there before. And then they just turned it into a studio for CBS FM.
Yeah, you could tell how tiny that studio was,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, it's not nearly as big as O&A's, for one. The big sprawling...
Yeah, Jesus. It looks
huge.
It's open concept.
I mean, it is Howard Stern's old studio.
Mm.
That when he left to do Sirius, O&A just got his old spot. If you watch Howard's show back in the E days, when he's sitting behind the table and whatever... Opie is sitting where Howard used to sit.
Oh, okay.
It's funny to, like, visualize.
Yeah, I don't really have a visual of that, but...
It's like when I go to the store that used to be the Circus City I used to work at.
Oh, yeah.
And you just point out, like, oh, that's where the TVs used to be. It's completely, like, it's almost unrecognizable. And then I was trying to figure out where the bathroom was, and I was like, oh, I think the bathroom is actually next door now. So much like their run-in with Carol Miller in 1999 from the Evolution of Rock and Roll, where they had their argument on air and Carol was talking about, like, this is the music I love, man. You can't stop me from playing my music.
Yeah.
An on-air incident we covered in a previous episode that's available in the archives. Anthony is very uncomfortable, knowing there will likely be consequences. In 1999, things got so bad, on and off air, between Carol and the boys. Carol was told by management to stay in the mail room until O&A were finished with their shift and out of the studio before she was allowed to set up for her show coming up next. It was actually to the point. It feels so long ago because I haven't listened to their NEW episodes for research for the show in so long. But they'd be in the last 10 or 15 minutes of their show talking about something, and you'd hear Carol try to chime in on the topic because she would have to get her stuff in.
Oh.
O&A show would end, they would go to a commercial break.
Overlap.
They'd come back. And Carol have to be there and set up. But, yeah, like, Opie was so annoyed that Carol was in the studio at all with them that management was like, yeah, okay, look, you can't. So it's funny to me, especially with what we know now, that it's very similar to how the relationship goes with Howard once they're all set up in the same Sirius building, with Stern requesting that O&A not be allowed to interact with him or not go down the portion of the building on the floor that his studio is on.
Well, yeah, because they're trolls.
Yeah.
Like...
Opie will say he didn't want to be a troll. Like, he just wanted to say hello. But I don't know about that.
They're just trolls. Like...
Yeah, if you were Howard, what would you want?
But also, I get it. I would want to work in a radio station that I could... I would want to work in a radio station where everyone's friends.
Yeah, you'd like to think that everyone's just friendly and you
could troll each other a little bit, just like,
yeah,
hey, what you listening to in there? I don't like that song.
Slam the door obnoxiously loud.
Yeah, like, well, I mean, you couldn't even slam it. It was just like,
yeah, it probably had a resistance to it.
Yeah, what are those, the thing you put on a door to make it soft shut or whatever?
Oh, yeah, it probably had that.
Yeah, that's what it looked like, and you can't really slam it.
But you need it to be loud enough so you can hear it.
Mm-hmm.
But it's funny. They followed him with a microphone, but you probably wouldn't have even had to.
Yeah.
How close O&A were, you probably would have been able to hear it just down the hall.
Mm-hmm.
If nothing else, I think the most obnoxious thing, though, is CBS FM would actually be playing their shit over the speakers outside their studio, so you could almost hear it during ONA's show. So it's like, come on. You gotta be at least a little bit more considerate than that. What do you expect?
Yeah.
This was a while ago, and I don't even know if we left it in, but we started talking about who would play ONA in a biopic.
Oh, yeah.
Someone asked us a comment a long time ago, and we never really got too big into a discussion about it. And while I've never been able to think further than casting Marc Maron as Anthony, which is pretty funny, considering how polar opposite the two are politically in 2023.
Yeah.
Marc Maron is extremely shitting on the you-can't-say-nothing-these-days comedians.
Mm-hmm.
And Anthony, that's like the only comedians he can be friends with.
Yeah.
Are the people in that, you know, anti-woke crowd.
Mm-hmm.
Maron is in studio for the XM portion of the show and is recently divorced, which gives Anthony an excuse to talk about his miserable marriage and divorce.
Did you love your wife? Seriously, at the beginning?
That's a tough question.
Think back, though.
I'm really thinking back, and I don't think I ever loved that woman.
Really? You just like being hurt?
Well, no. Can I speak for Anthony?
Yeah.
And Ann, just tell me to stop, but his wedding night,
yeah,
he laid in bed.
I laid in bed, and I was like, tears of frustration poured down my face.
He was crying on his wedding
night. As my eye twitched, and I went, oh, my God, I think I made a big mistake. That was day one. I went for 9 years. It was like the first day in prison when that door clangs shut, and you're just like, oh, my God, it's the first day of a 9-year sentence.
Oh, my God.
At least the wedding was nice, though, right? She behaved at the wedding.
Well, there were some altercations with my brother and my mother.
She got a...
Well, perhaps someone got a little sauced.
Don't know for sure.
And, yeah, there was a little altercation. Some yelling could have happened between my mom.
Yelling on the wedding.
And then my brother.
Anthony's ex-wife used to date his brother. So, when his wife got drunk at the wedding, she decides... And I remember him talking about this in an WNEW episode, was just yelling at his mom about how shitty his brother was. Because I guess she just felt, hey, I'm drunk. All these emotions are going to come flooding out.
Why would you marry your brother's ex?
If Anthony never loved Jennifer, as he claims here, I really do wonder, did Jennifer ever love him? Because he seems unlovable.
Why do miserable people marry each other?
I don't know.
Like,
according to the book, the only thing Anthony said was he was tired of being referred to as, like, his mom's son, and he wanted to, like, take, like, charge of his own adult life and be his own person.
So you get married?
Yeah.
Just move out. Just fucking go make a name for yourself.
Yeah. Like, that's really all you need.
Isn't that what you... we're working for?
What's the problem of being connected with the mom so bad when your dad was the biggest fucking piece of shit?
And you have your dad's name. Just change your name, dude.
Yeah, at that point.
Make a new name for yourself.
Yeah, we talked about this last time. Change your fucking name.
Change your fucking name. You're fucking, like, some people think, oh no, you know, I just really love my parents. So, like, I want to keep my parents' names and stuff like that. And it's like, but it's not even your parents' names. It's not even your parents' parents' names.
Yeah.
It's not even your parents' 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 names. It goes way far back to somebody who's probably racist.
Oh,
and, like,
most definitely.
Like, owned enslaved people. And it's just like, do you really want to keep that name that bad?
Yeah.
And it was all very... and I'm there trying to put out fires, you know, and thinking, and this is and I'm like, this is day one.
I got married in my backyard with like 7 people. It was sort of a panicky situation.
Yeah. Sounds like mine. It was a justice of the peace and, you know, backyard whole thing.
But you invited a lot of people, right?
No.
No?
Not that many people.
I know. My dad didn't even show up.
I didn't give a shit.
Yeah.
Why did he show up?
Why am I doing this?
I didn't tell him about it. I just was like, let's just get this done.
Yeah, that's good. That's good. Travis, he's described me as the fat new guy in Shawshank. I don't belong here. The guy that gets beaten the new fish and then dies.
Your dad didn't go to your wedding. He was out there in California, right?
No, he didn't go to the wedding thing. But then we had like a party of like a couple months later
and
to make
up
for not inviting everybody.
Right.
You know, get fucking roped in and captured first, and then we'll plan, you know, a party kind of a thing.
My dad's been no help now, I'll tell you. He's such
Really? Well,
he's a selfish bastard. He's one of those guys where it's like, everything starts with, you know what you gotta do? You know what you gotta do?
So I'm telling him about the divorce, and he's like, I told him, I talked to him for like 5 minutes, and it just sort of, that was the end of his patience with it. He goes, well, you got to kill her. You're just going to have to kill
Jesus.
Her. Like,
yeah.
Like, but it's like reasonable advice. He's like, no, listen. And, you know, you can't hire someone to do it. You got to do it yourself.
Yeah, I don't know if that's just a bit or...
I have no idea.
If that's a shoot from Mark, but yeah, that's scary as shit. We're talking about a conversation, I guess this conversation went a while, and they even talked during the commercial, but Opie talks about something that Anthony said during the commercial break that made one person on the bleachers uncomfortable.
It didn't feel good.
By the way, you made the black guy on the bleachers very uncomfortable during the break.
Oh, what happened?
The ranting and the raving continued during the break, and Ant might have said something that made the black guy very uncomfortable.
About sucking black cock?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
You wish somebody would
I just wish
so destitute that they'd have to suck black cock for crack, and the black guy hanging with all the white people out there got a little uncomfortable. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah. I realize how you can figure out how, some people say I'm not racist. I'm not racist at all. And I finally figured out that there's a way you can figure out if you're racist.
Right.
There is. It's because it happened to me. The next time you lose something that you think's been stolen, see how you cast that short mystery film in your head. Now, how many ethnic types do you use in the lead role? Yeah, yeah. How many blacks and Latinos do you get to before you finally hear yourself say, oh, fuck, here it is under the car seat. Oh, I'm an asshole.
Oh, shit.
I'm a little racist, but I'm not going to tell my buddy Leroy because he'd be uncomfortable.
That's very funny. That's a great line, man.
Because I always think, like, I always say that, like, I'm not racist, I'm nervous.
There you go. I mean?
It's not ethnicity based. It's case by case, and that's phase one. You know, when nervousness becomes fear, and then it becomes hate based on a certain group of people, then you're fucking racist.
Then
but
you're
if
racist.
You're just nervous, you're phase one. Just hang out at phase one and
phase one is
and protect yourself. Yeah,
he's talking about the racism spectrum too. There, honestly,
and he's 100% describing Anthony.
Yeah. Yeah.
But
indirectly, he's trying. When I'm like that, that's such a great soft sell.
Yeah.
Where it's like, I'm going to pretend I'm projecting this onto you, but I'm sort of just reverse projecting it onto me.
Yeah.
So you feel more comfortable about maybe approaching your own racism, maybe?
And I don't even know if Maron is that familiar with Anthony as a person.
Mm-hmm.
He might not even, it might just be part of his bit, but he might not know that, yeah, he is 100% describing Anthony, who is like, when we were talking about in the last episode, the guy who came in and was talking about how the media sells you the stories about the home invasions and everything.
Yeah.
And in a clip I was listening to, Anthony 100% said, like, yep, it worked on me. Like, he's admitting to the fact that, he basically was just told by media to be afraid of black people and said, okay.
Yeah, don't mind me. Don't mind if I do.
I'm going to buy that 100%. I'm not going to push back on that or try to,
but the rest
of
the media, lies.
All of this lies, but the home invasion, I'm going to believe that
100%. All the racist stuff, true.
Yeah,
everything else lies.
Mark, we should tell you there's light at the end of the tunnel because Anthony's quite happy these days. He's in a pretty cool relationship. And
you do move on even with the baggage that you have as long as, there's a light at the end of the tunnel.
And I think he'll get married again.
Why do you think that? Are you just doing that as a bit for the show?
I think he'll get married again.
Do you seriously believe that?
Why do miserable people get married? And I don't mean just people who are like, they got feelings. And, they're depressed sometimes. I mean, like, miserable people who are like, I hate women. I'm also racist and all this other shit. I just hate people. Why get married?
Yeah.
Obviously, you hate people.
And how does the other person just stand by and be okay with how miserable you are? Like, I want to be around this miserable person.
If they're miserable, too.
The misery loves company?
Yeah, I mean, misery definitely loves company. And I feel like misery loves the company of other misery.
Yeah, you get to argue and, not argue, but you get to, be miserable together.
Yeah.
And that's comfortable.
Yeah, and like, especially depending on, like, what kind of family you grew up in, being miserable together is super comforting for some people.
Yeah.
You know?
I mean, it's definitely... It makes sense with the trajectory of Antholini and how that ends up.
Are you spoiling it? And you're telling me they don't get married?
No.
They don't get married and have kids and turn into nice people?
I recently sent you Jill Nicolini's Twitter page.
Mm-hmm.
where her pinned tweet or most recent tweet up to that point was talking about Polishore and Biodome. I don't think that's the most recent tweet anymore. But
bummer.
It's just your typical, again, it's like a Facebook page, but on Twitter. Hey, here's these pictures of my kids. How funny my kids are, how cute my kids are. It's just funny to picture Anthony being part of that world at all.
Yeah, no, I was just reminded how somebody who I don't, I'll preface this by saying, I don't really talk to them. Mm. It was somebody who I was trying to be friends with, but like they rubbed me the wrong way in a few ways and also never reached out to me. So it was just like, okay, we're just sort of acquaintances that follow each other. And recently they posted a story or picture. I said yes.
Oh.
And I immediately unfollowed them. It's sort of like when, in a similar way, if somebody is like, same instance where it's just like, we're just sort of acquaintances that follow each other, and they post like this big old birthday thing, and I'm like, oh, thank you for reminding me to unfollow you, just because we don't talk. If I follow you and I have no desire to say happy birthday to you, then why am I following you?
That is that's a big
tell. I'm gonna unfollow you. Happy birthday.
Yeah,
happy birthday to me.
If I don't care about this life-changing moment in your life of either getting married,
yeah,
or I'm pregnant. It's like, great.
Unfollow. Yeah, there are very, very, very few people that I would give a shit about if they got pregnant and like we're going to have kids or adopting or going to have kids or something.
Especially because you know that that's just going to be what the timeline is.
That is going to be your timeline for the next like 3.5-5 years.
I don't care about that.
I am sorry, buddy. I don't give a shit about your kid. Oh, your kid pooped. Oh, your kid's walking. Oh, your kid's sleeping. Oh, your kid's falling.
If I'm not on your short list to watch the kid if you have to go out of town, why would I
care?
If
I'm not the godparent, why should I give a shit?
Yeah. I mean, it's true.
Don't make me watch this shit.
Oh, God, no.
It's
no,
like,
I'm sorry.
Kids themselves, they're fine.
Yeah.
Kids existing, they're fine.
Yeah.
It's whatever.
We're not, you know, team fuck all kids, them kids.
We,
you know.
There are plenty of times that I, if there's any resentment I have toward kids, it's because of my own childhood projecting that onto them.
Yeah, same.
Like, if I see, but at the same time, if I see kids in a, like, wholesome, like, if I'm walking around and I see some kids having fun with their parents, I'm like, oh, that's so great.
Yeah.
It warms my heart. But, like, there's also that layer of, like, oh, you're posting your kids all over social media. They have no way of consenting to that.
That's true,
and
too.
And I wonder if part... I grew up, I found all my baby pictures and stuff.
Yeah.
I destroyed them all.
Yeah.
And my mom was, like, so upset about it. And it's just like, they're fucking my pictures.
Yeah.
They're of me. Like, and then I stole them all. And so, like, I don't know. I just can't imagine what it would feel like to be a kid today and then grow up 20 years from now and be like, oh, look, I just found mom's old Instagram. Wow, that's like literally me naked in the bathtub. Like,
yeah, why what so the fuck? Many pictures and videos of me that I had no idea were being seen by.
Yeah, it would be one thing if it was like one or two.
Yeah.
In some like discreet kind of way. Like, oh, they're all comfied up. They're just like, blah, 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 blah. But like, it just. This is just a rant on top of a rant on top of a rant, because now I'm going to go into abortion topics.
Oh, well, okay.
Where it's like, so many people scream that life starts at conception. But you're still just literally treating your kids as like dogs by taking pictures of them without their consent and just putting them all over the internet, making them do goofy shit, pranking them, trolling them. And it's just like...
making them cry for clicks.
Yeah, I can't help, but... in my head, overlap those people, the people who are pro-life and also pro-trolling your kids.
Yeah.
And, like, posting your kids all over the internet to, like, profit off of in some way, shape, or form.
I do respect Opie that I've never seen his kids.
Yeah.
There's no reason for me to see his kids.
There's no reason for anybody to see anybody. It's one thing if you, like, privately send it to a family member.
Sure.
Which is still, you know, dubious in my opinion, but to have so many on your social media,
yeah,
why would anybody want to follow that?
Yeah, I don't.
Other than, like, the godparent or the grandparent or whatever.
Yeah, you want to check up and you
see. Yeah, be like, oh, I'm so glad they're doing good. They're taking the first poops.
I like when people post pictures of their babies, but their babies have, like, an emoji over their face.
Yeah.
And it's like, I don't need to see that fucking
kid. It's the baby. The baby's here, and I'm enjoying life with my baby, but, you know, you don't have to see the baby.
Yeah, no.
Yeah.
You want to preserve the privacy of the kid, and I respect that.
Yeah.
So that cookout that was supposed to happen at the end of July that ends up happening a month later, that's still in play. That's still on the table. But during their vacation, because after the first, they take a few days off and they're not back until the 7th, Antholini decided to hold a party for just their family members. The Kumia family and the Nicolina family can come over to the Kumia compound, hang out, have dinner or whatever.
Compound.
So they decide that they are going to make a very special announcement to the families now that they got them all in one place. And let's see how that goes.
Jill's sister is crying. Sal is going, I told you, Ro. I told you. I knew it. I knew it. My mother's face is just red. Both families are just drop-jawed.
They stop breathing.
Yeah, yeah. Everyone's still holding their glass up. And so they have a very special announcement to make. We saved a boatload of cash on our auto insurance with Geico. I used a hacky Geico commercial line, and you could not see two more pissed off families in your life. Oh, were they angry?
I only included that because of how fucking hacky the Geico joke was, and I could not fucking believe that they actually went with that.
Free advertisement?
Right, are they sponsors? Oh, no. Not an ad. Hashtag not an ad. So here's actually where we might get some conversation rolling for the last clips here. We've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. They've had Dana White, abusive asshole and president of the UFC, as a guest on the show a couple times. And because of that, he's invited Jim Norton and other comedian Bob Kelly to come down for the next pay-per-view. A writer for a pop culture blog did a write-up on the event and talked about the celebrities in attendance and hurt Jim's feelings.
Yeah, I would like to ask for just a little fan assistance, if I could.
Oh, no.
Why? The fans are very helpful.
Oh, no.
And they know the type of tool this guy obviously is.
Oh, no. Go ahead.
And he wrote the celebrity roll call for the fight. Anthony Kiedis, of course, from Chili Peppers. Tito Ortiz and Jenna Jameson. Peter Wentz. That guy who's married to Ashley Simpson, that L.A. fruit with his hoodie.
That spins records.
Yeah, I see. He was the Dana White's party spinning. I'm just like, why would... What? Stop trying to look tortured. You're not interesting, you L.A. fairy. You little hoodie. Oh, what's this guy about?
Yeah, I look at guys like this, What is his name?
Peter Wentz.
And you look at him, and you're like, how does he get the job done? How does he get the job of being a guy done? You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
They're calling him a beta?
They're calling him a beta, yeah.
Which, I mean, let's face it, Pete Wentz probably would assign beta to himself.
Sure, sure.
And his fucking live journal shit.
It's really, half of this conversation is just them being pissed off at Pete Wentz for some reason.
For some, just existing.
Grown men being mad at Pete Wentz for presenting himself differently than they're used to grown men presenting themselves.
And like, being queer in some way that they can just sense.
Yeah, like, not even knowing, but perceiving.
Yeah, wait, what year is this?
This is 2009.
Wow.
I'm sorry, 2008.
It's because he's so popular. They're not even acknowledging the fact that he's in Fall Out Boy. They're just like, oh, he's just married to Ashley Simpson.
He's married to Ashley Simpson, and he was spinning records at Dana White at a Dana White party. It's very weird that he was DJing.
Not really.
Is it not?
He gets around in the weirdest ways, especially with, like, celebrities.
I just think it's weird that you would invite Pete Wentz and then have him work.
He probably volunteered.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Like, it feels like, because what makes more sense to me is that you just have him there as a guest and then you would just hire a DJ. Because I don't know him as a DJ. I just know him as a member of a band.
Yeah.
But if he DJs too, then yeah, sure, okay.
Yeah, it's weird.
Why do chicks like guys like that?
Because they're dumb, and he's trying too hard. He's trying too hard to be this interesting, sullen soul. Like, wow, man, that's a pretty dark guy. What's going on with him? No one cares what's going on.
Wow, you got to wear the eyeliner because you're your soul is tortured.
Yeah. You're a girl in a hoodie.
Look, exactly.
You look sweet. I wanted to kiss him.
Yeah, put a shirt on under the hoodie, you queer.
And then someone just decides, hey, we should play some Fall Out Boy under this. So they start playing their Beat It cover.
Of all the songs.
Does nobody there know? In 2008, Fall Out Boy is established.
Yeah, a little bit. Like, I just love the rage of just a not toxically masculine guy existing.
Yeah.
And they're just like so threatened by it.
Jim, who I know is projecting, because Jim went through a period of in his life of, you know, wanting to seem, you know, emo in his day because he dealt with depression and everything. So now, mm-hmm. of course, anyone dealing with depression or whatever
is a poser.
Is a poser or wanting attention because Jim recognizes that his feelings were a literal cry for help. But as we've talked about during that episode where Opie talks about his feelings about people who attempt suicide and all that, someone crying out for help isn't a problem, but it's a person being selfish and making it a problem for everyone else. And that cries for help aren't worth addressing.
Yeah, that false narrative that, like, oh, a cry for help, it's just a cry for help. It's like, fucking help them. Help them. Like, why are we all turning away?
I don't understand the mentality that someone, you know, crying for help and hurting themselves, like, oh, I know they're not really depressed, though. Why would you assume that?
Yeah, it's only worth a look if, like, they commit and go through with it. And then it's like, oh, great, look, it's too late. Aren't y'all happy now? Like, it's such a fucked narrative.
Yeah, it's like, do you just not... I can only assume that it's people just don't believe that depression exists. Because why would you look at that and or not think this person needs help?
They just lack compassion.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, they're just so wrapped up in themselves and also not giving themselves compassion that they see other people doing it. And it's like, well,
you must just want attention.
Yeah, you just want attention. I'm not going to give you that. I'm not going to give. It'll, if I give you attention, then it'll just encourage this behavior.
It's right.
Like, that's like this weird ideology of just like, oh, if I give you the attention you are screaming for, then it'll just encourage this behavior. It's like, or you could help somebody. Or you can help somebody.
I don't want to be bothered, though. I got way too much stuff going on.
Yeah.
Out here trying to get attention for myself.
Yeah, it also feels like with the Pete Wentz thing that they're jealous.
Oh, yeah. Like, when Opie says, why do girls go for guys like that? That is 100%. Why? Yeah, like, why isn't it me?
Yeah, why
it
not
should me? Have been me! I'm
How
over here
he
in a
genuine.
I'm over here in a boring button-up and jeans. Why aren't girls going for that?
Yeah, like,
it's not the fucking style, dude.
Pete Wentz is one of those people that is like sort of the epitome of putting yourself out there.
Yeah,
like we've all seen Pete's dick. We've all read his live journal. We all know like how he's gotten around. And by we, I mean, you know, the emos.
I was gonna say, I just want to put it out there that I've never seen Pete Wentz's dick.
The moment the rumor got out that Pete Wentz had his dick online, everyone in class was just like, "Oh, really? We have to know now. Even if we're not like." I was more of a Patrick Stump fan. Like Patrick Stump's just cuter to me.
Mm.
Pete Wentz is. I will say, back in the day, especially, I definitely felt that Pete Wentz was like a tryhard.
Oh,
in terms of very transparent with everything on his live journal. And so it was just sort of like, leave a little bit of mystery. Well, transparent about the band. Because, especially where songs and lyrics came from.
Oh, yeah.
And so it was just like, it was cool to like follow the trail to it, but also like, oh, so this song is just about, you know, this. That's all it's about. This
song's
just about Mikey Way.
Yeah.
Like, this song's about Mikey Way. Oh my god, that song's also about Mikey Way? So it was just, I don't know, I was just sort of like put off by it, but now I'm just sort of like, it's whatever, it's cool that it was there.
Yeah.
You know, it's sort of like an archive of like,
I like the insight.
Yeah. But Yeah, he got around everywhere. He would cameo at every fucking video and party that he could.
Oh yeah,
he just liked to get out there, and I think that's part of the offense that people found, where it was just like, oh, how dare he put himself out there like that? And it's like, these fucking old men on this podcast, they think they're putting themselves out there, but they're not. Jim is more than anybody else.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, like, he's actually like, he'll show the vulnerability. Anthony's over there telling us about, you know, some things.
There's a film over everything Anthony says that's just this thin veneer of, oh, but I don't care, it didn't affect me.
Oh yeah, Jim will straight up tell you, I heard a clip yesterday, and I forget when it was from, that it was like, it was in the 2000s, that a girl broke up with him, and he cried and crawled up a staircase because he couldn't walk. He was so broken up about it. Anthony would never tell you that story. No. Opie would never tell you that story.
Yeah.
Jim is the kind of person who will tell you that he had fantasies of suicide by cop, that he actually, like, wanted to run out and attack at cops so they would shoot him.
Mm-hmm.
His attempts.
Yeah.
He is extremely transparent.
Yeah.
And I do respect that. And it does, unfortunately, make for some of the funnier moments on the show in some instances. Like when he said, he was a really big Kiss fan. That's like one of his favorite bands is Kiss. Kiss and Black Sabbath are the two biggies. That he was hanging out with a girl, and his attempt at trying to be smooth was saying, well, you know what, you know the name of my favorite band, right? Like, that was his try to, like, way to get a Kiss. Bands Kiss. Oh, no! Yeah, she guesses the wrong one. No. Hold on. The, like, hearing about pathetic Jim is very funny, especially if we keep people who, like me, can relate and be like, oh, I have tons of pathetic childhood stories that I can see myself,
yeah.
You know, like, oh, I could totally relate to that. Like, that shit's funny to me.
Yeah.
Yeah, but O and A are never the same.
I find it funny that growing up in middle school and high school, I always felt that if there were any bands that I would compare MCR or, like, you know, whatever to, it would be, like, Kiss.
Oh, wow.
Or maybe Black Sabbath. And not in terms of musicality. Well, no.
Theatrics.
Makeup.
Yeah.
Aesthetic.
Mm-hmm.
But also musicality in the sense that it was not hard enough for the metal crowd.
Yeah.
And it wasn't soft enough for the pop crowd. But there was this in-between group of people who were just like, kill the party, the cringes. And just went to shows in makeup.
Yeah.
All decked out. Part of the fucking scene. And I'm like, MCR and Kiss are a lot similar in that regard. And I could say the same thing about Black Sabbath.
Yeah.
Like, oh, the makeup.
Yeah.
The eyeliner. Oh, I'm so tortured.
Yeah, it's like, look at Ozzy. Are you kidding me?
Look at Ozzy. Ozzy was like the original emo kid. Like, come on.
I seriously, yeah, you bring up a very good point. You cannot look at things like, you have to be self-aware as a Kiss fan. You had to have looked at what you were doing there. I'll say this. It's very like being a wrestling fan.
Yeah.
You need to acknowledge how corny wrestling is. Because if you're seriously one of these people here who is so taking it super serious, it's not for you, man.
No.
Just watch UFC.
Some Greco-Roman shit.
Exactly. Like, if you're all about the, you know, if you don't like a comedy skit here and there, you don't like a comedy spot.
Yeah, if you don't want some fun face paint.
You have to acknowledge certain things are camp.
Yeah, and I think that he's just projecting on wishing he was as
interesting.
As interesting as Pete Wentz. And Pete Wentz is boring as shit.
Yeah,
it's just that he's fucking popping up left and right everywhere.
The whole people trying to, oh, he's just wanting to seem more interesting. All that sounds like projecting.
And he's already got a wife. Like, what do you think his goal is? Maybe he's just genuinely, well, yeah, for now. Maybe he's just genuinely wanting to be this person and show up like this in the world.
Yeah.
God forbid.
The fuck's the problem?
Also, God forbid he be a little gay. Like,
oh, yeah.
If he was hyper-masculine, they wouldn't give a shit. Ozzy?
Oh, yeah. Ozzy's not hyper-masculine. Not at all.
Compared to Pete Wentz?
I don't know.
I would say Ozzy's more mask than Pete Wentz.
Yeah, maybe. I'm just thinking about the time and how they presented themselves and how they dressed. I think it's very funny now that we actually address this, that Jimmy is so against this shit, looking at the bands he likes.
Yeah.
He absolutely should be eating this kind of stuff up.
Either eating it up or at least respecting it.
If you don't like the music, I get it. And I don't expect someone like Jim in 2008 to like Fall Out Boy's music.
Yeah.
I didn't either, you know? But that's also coming from someone who, there was a lot of stuff around that time that I told myself to not like. You know?
Right, yeah.
Like, stuff that either didn't feel safe to like, or, you know, like, I was very anti-MCR at the time, too.
Mm-hmm.
Just for whatever reasons.
Yeah, but, wait, why were you MCR, anti-MCR? How could you do that? How could you do this to me?
I wasn't a I secretly was trying to present that I didn't like the makeup, even though I did, but I didn't want to seem like I did because...
Gerard Way is super cute.
Because that could be gay. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. You don't want to let people know that.
If you like MCR, we all know why.
Yeah. Yeah. So, it was a lot of that. It was a lot of self-preservation, still wanting to seem super... super masculine.
Yeah. When I first met you,
yeah.
I was like, damn, this person's so masculine.
I was oozing machismo, was I not?
The way you were masculine left and right, it was a mess. It was more like mescaline, honestly. You were so masculine, you were mescaline.
Whoa. What is mescaline?
It's like a kind of recreational drug.
Oh, okay.
That gives you nice feelings. Unlike masculinity.
Oh. Someone has to make a pun about that, right? Masculinity?
Masculinity.
Toxic masculinity?
Yeah.
Someone out there, run with that.
I wonder, you don't have to keep this in, but I wonder if part of helping you see yourself was me not seeing you as super masculine, where it's just like...
And being okay with it?
Yeah.
Yeah, probably.
Where it's just like... Oh, you're so sweet. You're so nice. I like you. I like you. You're nice. I like you. You're cute. And it's just, it's not like projecting a bunch of societal expectations of masculinity on you.
Yeah.
There were some. I definitely projected some. But in the end, it was just like, I could be that. I could do those things either for myself or for them. And then like have that fun dynamic. Because it's the dynamic that's fun. Yeah. It's not the requirement.
Right.
Know?
Yeah. No. Not at all. Don't worry. We hear more about Wentz, so we're not out of the woods yet.
He shows up in the studio.
Oh, my God.
He would.
And he picks a fight with the John Cena cutout. I don't know why there was a John Cena standee. You pointed that out.
You know why.
Oh.
Toxic masculinity.
Oh. We need Cena around to protect us.
Cena is the epitome of toxic masculinity. I'm so sorry.
We're going to put Cena on a train track. And scare away the people from CBS when they see his silhouette dancing in the window.
Continuing the celebrity roll call, Laura Prepon, Mandy Moore, Chris Angel, and then he puts Jim Norton and in parentheses comedian. Does he count?
No hate for Chris Angel?
No, they like Chris Angel.
They like Chris Angel, but they hate Pete Wentz?
Yeah.
That is fucking hilarious.
Yeah.
And then he puts Jim Norton and in parentheses comedian. Does he count? I'll leave it up to you. And then Wilmer Valderrama. So I didn't like his little slam.
It is a slam.
Of course it is. He's a he's a douche. And maybe the fans, if you could just send him a friendly email, because he should know who counts and who doesn't. But
how many times have you done Leno and stuff and Letterman?
One Letterman, five Lenos.
Yeah, five Lenos.
Five Lenos?
You've done five Lenos, HBO specials.
Yeah, half hour HBO, hour on HBO.
I mean, this guy... is an unknowing douche.
He probably knows, but just doesn't like me. Hey, sorry I'm not starring in That 70s Show. I'm sure it's your favorite sitcom. Sorry I'm not starring in that.
That's been off the air for a couple of years.
Oh, is it? Yeah. It shows you what I know.
Yeah.
My God, this is pathetic.
He's not laughing at it at
all.
No,
this
ain't
funny.
He's not like, oh, that's fucking fun. Because that, to me, it feels like a funny jab you would do at a comedian who can take
a
joke.
Right? It's very funny how... much time of their show they spend shitting on people. And
the moment they get a taste of it.
The littlest bit.
The most milquetoast kind of shit on.
It's, I want the fans to fucking attack him on my behalf.
Drag him.
I can't, ugh.
Can we get into the Zemo thing for a second? Stephen S. from Bayshore, he writes something good. There's nothing more annoying than an adult emo douche.
Yeah.
What is that whole emo thing about?
It's not being tortured.
How do you walk around like that?
It's probably a bunch of spoiled kids who are trying too hard to look like they have angst. And they're just a bunch of attention nerds who, like, they think that their sadness is so intriguing. Like, wow. Intriguing. Why are you so sad? Let's not forget our own lives. Let's get to you. What's that sadness about, man?
I love seeing the 16-year-old girls that dress. It used to be goth. Now I guess it's emo. I don't know. Someone else could help me out with the facts there. And yeah, you're like, why are you tortured? You're only 16.
Oh, but parents don't understand.
Don't understand what?
I don't know.
I think me, an elder emo, I proclaim that the emo aesthetic and emo way of life to a degree is one of the first signs that our generation, millennials, were ready to confront like systemic and what is it? Intergenerational trauma.
Like, are we serious? Okay. Opie is setting the bar. 16. What has got you depressed by 16?
Huh.
What could Anthony possibly be upset or depressed about by the time he was 16?
Hmm.
How much incredible, insane bullshit he was fucking put through by his dad specifically.
Yeah.
Oh, but what could I possibly be sad about at 16?
This assumption, this presumption that if you're young, you have no problems is so infuriating.
Yeah.
And I think that's a big part of emo, where it's like, oh, you genuinely think we have no problems. Like, look at the demographics in terms of self-harm.
Yeah.
You think that emo kids are just doing self-harm because of, like, it's an aesthetic? Or do you think that the self-harm lends itself to being more aware of where you are emotionally, and music that resonates with it makes you feel seen and not alone.
I'm sad, I'm cutting myself. Where would that have possibly have come from by being inspired by the art? As someone who was more in tune with emo stuff at that time.
Where would that have come from? I mean,
idea or tried to emulate it?
So I don't think it's necessarily about emulation.
That's what I'm trying to get at.
Yeah, it's more so it was already happening. Self-harm just it happens.
Right.
And self-harm comes about in a lot of different ways.
Yeah.
Whether it be substance abuse, putting yourself in situations that you know are bad, high-risk behavior, or physical self-harm, like piercings, tattoos. I, as a person with piercings and tattoos, I would say that I, at times, utilize those as a form of self-harm.
Mm.
And self-harm is not always trying to hurt yourself.
Mm.
Because it's not so simple as, I'm trying to hurt myself. It's as simple, you're trying to come back to your body in a way that feels safe to you.
Right.
And pain often feels safer than pleasure or numbness. Mm. And numbness can be so like all consuming that we want to break from the numbness. So the ideal way to come back to your body by, you know, finding safety in it. A lot of us don't feel safe in our bodies. So we're like, oh, you know what? I could go for another tattoo.
Mm.
I could go for a stick poke. I could go for a DIY piercing. I could go for like a professional piercing maybe. And that pain, like imagine the last time you hurt yourself accidentally and how visceral that was in your body. And like, that's a very different feeling than the typical, oh, I'm going about my day.
You're super aware.
You're so aware of it.
Yeah.
There's no escaping the pain in your body. And in the aspect of it being a coping mechanism, I respect it. In the aspect of it being an unhealthy coping mechanism, I still respect it. But I think everyone has to come to terms with the fact that there are other ways to feel safe in your body.
Yeah.
And it's hard to do that, though. And so, like, I think what was happening with the emo culture was that everyone was already self-harming in some way, shape, or form. And then people started being forward in their songs about it.
Mm, like actually acknowledging that it was a thing.
That they were singing about it. And like, I mean, something as cheesy as like Hawthorne Heights, like cut my wrist and black my eyes and shit. Emo music was very transparent about extremely hard topics.
Mm.
Like sexual assault, getting abused by your parents, suicide, self-harm. They weren't pussyfooting around it. They were singing about the things that were genuinely affecting so many people, especially young people.
Mm.
And so we would be hearing this and be like, wow, yeah, they get me. This band gets me. And with like MCR for me, it was a band that I could listen to that basically served as an emotional outlet for me. I didn't have to be the one screaming all the things.
Oh, yeah, okay.
I could just sing along to the song that was screaming all the things that resonated with me.
Mm.
Same with, like, The Used and Fall Out Boy and, like, these bands that made... And I think that's a big... That's what music is all about, is feeling seen and heard by people that you idolize to some degree. So you feel like, oh, I'm not the shitty things I say about myself.
Mm.
I'm just like Gerard Way. I'm just like Pete Wentz. I'm just like these people who are writing lyrics to these songs that I love so much. And we all have our demons and stuff like that. And they're still at rejects from society, and I'm rejects from society. And it just gave a lot of people an outlet to do it. And I think anybody can relate to emo music.
Mm.
Like, you see people now who, oh, here are my emo pictures from back in the day. And now they're like the most basic bitch that you could think about.
Yeah.
And it's, you don't see that and think like, poser. Very, very rarely were people genuinely calling people posers in terms of emo, because everybody can be emo.
Mm-hmm.
You know, emo's a spectrum.
Why I dress like this?
You're 16 years old, man. It's the best time of your life.
Literally the worst time of my life. Like, 14 to 17? No. No. Not good years.
That's extremely... I'm just going to talk for everybody in the room. Oh, just because Opie was happy at 16, everybody was? You please shut the fuck up, my guy.
And that's the thing. That's what I'm fucking saying. Like, they're like, you sh... And I don't think it's a matter of, oh, everyone has a good time at 16. I think it's more of a, you should be grateful.
Yeah.
Projecting that concept. It's like, for what?
Also, when someone says, oh, those are the happiest times of your life, that just makes everything afterwards.
It's like,
you don't have to say how shitty it is, but you're saying how shitty everything after that was.
Yeah.
I think that's just not having to say it, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I don't mind. Wait till you get out of, like, school and have to, like, work
for
a living.
I'm a cutter. I'm a cutter, too. Are you? Why don't you start with your throat?
I laugh at the cutters.
That's like one of the least emo fucking songs of their fucking shit. Hold on.
It's just the song that someone in the studio knows.
So here's like a poem.
Oh, okay.
That is at the beginning of a Used song.
Oh, okay.
And it's called I'm a Fake. And I feel like this song is like a very... It's an anthem for some people.
Hmm.
But it starts with... Small, simple, safe price. Rise the wake and carry me with all of my regrets. This is not a small cut that scabs and dries and flakes and heals. And I am not afraid to die. I'm not afraid to bleed and fuck and fight. I want the pain of payment. What's left but a section of pygmy-sized cuts. Much like a slew of 1,000 unwanted fucks. Would you be my little cut? Would you be my 1,000 fucks? And make Mark leaving space for the guilt to be liquid, to fill and spill over and under my thoughts. My sad, sorry, selfish cry out to the cutter. I'm cutting, trying to picture your black, broken heart. Love is not like anything, especially a fucking knife. There's so much meaning to the poem and to the act of self-harm. Because self-harm, in a lot of ways, is like a cry for help.
Yeah.
And so many people immediately hopped on cutters and like totally disregarded any truth to what they were doing.
Oh yeah.
And they put them in rehab facilities, and they would like put them on a lot of medication. And these are, I get it, these are ways that you're trying to help, but then there was just the general populace of just like, oh, what are you, a cutter? Yeah. It's like, oh, boo-hoo, what's so bad about your life? Like, the whole thing they're trying to say.
Yeah.
It's just like...
It comes right back to that same thing. Opie's trying to go back to that same discussion we had during the other discussion about Opie saying, I laugh at the cutters. Why?
Why?
What? Like,
why?
It's not like you're paying them attention anyway.
Yeah, exactly. It's what, not like who do you know?
Yeah, it's not like you are dropping what you're doing and paying attention anyway, so just fucking shut up.
I don't mind the teenagers as much, because they're teenagers. But when you get to be an adult male DJ...
Yeah.
Well, how old is this Pete Wentz?
Peter Wentz.
I'm calling him Pete. He's an adult. He's not Peter anymore. Yeah. It's Pete. It's Mr. Wentz.
I would think it's the other way around.
Yeah, you would think, right?
You don't call him Pete Griffin.
Yeah. Peter's a kid's name? Pete is the adult name? And yeah, most people were calling him Pete Wentz. I don't know why the blogger...
Yeah, why do they keep saying Peter?
Because the blogger said Peter. I guess the blogger might not know who the fuck he is then in that case.
Wow. Why are you wearing a hoodie with no shirt underneath?
Oh, and there he is with the white t-shirt and the hat. Just stop.
How scandalous.
A white t-shirt and a hat. I've had it with you. I can't stand your white t-shirt and hat.
Spoon.
Almost 30. Stop trying to look like you're on the Lower East Side. You're not gritty. All right, stop trying to dress like you're not Robert Blake in 1977, idiot. You're a DJ with a hoodie, a little sweet, too small hoodie, and like the little angst pants pulled down, have your butt cheeks hanging out. Ain't you cute?
He's attracted to Pete Wentz. That's the bit. He's attracted to Pete Wentz.
Yeah. Why would you be spending this much time on it?
What are you doing?
You gotta think like Ashley Simpson, you know, maybe as a goof it was kind of cool, I guess, to go out with this guy. I don't know. But you got to think she wants a real man at this point. Like a UFC fighter. She doesn't want this crap.
Now we're just going to speak for Ashley Simpson. Which, yeah, I mean...
Ashley, have you heard Ashley Simpson's music? Oh my God. They're like... If not meant to be best friend... If not meant to be married, they're meant to be best friends. Like, come on.
Who did Ashley Simpson end up with after her and Pete broke up?
I don't remember.
Well, I'm curious now... Because it's saying, you obviously don't want someone like Pete. You want a real man.
You want a UFC fighter, specifically.
Yeah, you want a UFC fighter. Okay, cool. Who's she end up with? Evan Ross.
Sounds like a Disney actor.
He was in the comedy drama ATL. He was in the movie Pride. And he was in the Hunger Games Mockingjay Part 1 and 2.
Okay, well, give me his face. I do not recognize that guy from
not the
games.
Most masculine looking person from the picture.
No, he's very pretty.
So, wrong again, I guess.
Yeah.
Didn't end up with a UFC fighter. Sorry, Ope. Didn't end up with a 50-year-old DJ. I'm sorry.
There's this weird, like, fetishism of, oh, that woman, I'd like to see that woman with, like, a big, burly man.
Yeah.
It's just like,
why?
Why? Yeah, you're not fucking... big and burly.
Right, exactly.
So why do you want to see her with that? Like,
yeah. Opie's been talking about how much he's been watching Extreme Home Makeovers.
Wow, so masculine.
Well, this is the thing. He talks about how he's watching the show and how he can't help but cry a little bit. And Bob Kelly's in studio and he says he cries a little bit too. And specifically, they're talking about an episode where I think a...
is it the episode where their black family and they go into the house and they reveal the house to them and the woman's just like, what is this? no, we're changing this. We're making she did me wrong.
No, it's not that.
I cried at that one.
It's the big Move That Bus show.
Oh, wait, am I thinking of Trading Spaces?
I think, yeah, you're thinking of Trading Spaces.
Trading Spaces was such a troll show.
Yeah, that's...
Just neighbors wanting to troll each other.
100%. Yeah.
Okay,
Extreme Home Makeovers is, like, usually there is a sob story of some sort. We either
Huntington?
Have... Huh?
I don't remember the host's name. Ty something.
Oh, yeah, I think you're right. We either got a family that's, you know, that's poor and can't afford the renovations they need.
And now they can't afford the taxes on the house
and
after the renovation.
It gets repossessed and they can't live there anymore.
Yeah, that's great.
That's how it always ends up.
Happily ever after.
Or, you know, we have a child with a disability and the house needs to be made accessible. Yeah. So now they make it accessible and they move the bus and oh my God. So in this incident, it's, I think... What?
The way you led that up. There's a child with a disability, and they need to make the house accessible, and then they make the house accessible, and then they move that bus, and oh my god! And I just imagine, oh no, they ran over the child. Oh no! Oh my god! Oh my god!
Look away!
Tears!
Oh, it's even worse.
Oh my god! That's the way you were building it up like that.
I think the first was in the Navy, and they're talking about. Either they had a friend who, like, died in the line of duty or something, and they come back, and all of them huddle around the flag, and they salute the flag, and it's a big, you know, rah-rah Navy moment. And they're crying, so at home, you're crying, so that brings up, would Anthony cry at this? That's the main thing, that's what we're getting at.
Okay, I want to speculate what Anthony would cry over, because I don't think he would cry over this.
No, I don't think so either. Spoiler, no, he doesn't. He wouldn't. If he even saw it, he wouldn't.
Yeah.
That's the worst clip from the show. Come on. Yeah. There's a clip where they show the flagpole and all the Marines are crying.
Well, is it good audio, though, or can you not hear it?
Yeah, you just hear, like, grown tough men just crying and hugging each other.
That
would make you cry, Anthony.
That wasn't. No, the other clip was a little more intense than that.
Anthony's very sensitive. I'm surprised.
I'm very sensitive.
Why do you fight that? How do you block that part of yourself?
Yeah, why do you block that?
Sometimes,
you're a sweet guy.
Sometimes during a movie, if I feel a little emotional, I'll bite my tongue real hard.
Sounds like self-harm.
Oh, no.
Sometimes self-harm is used to blunt emotions.
That's true.
Like when you're feeling really angry or really sad and you just can't handle the emotions.
Ugh.
So maybe you bite your tongue, maybe you punch a wall, maybe you fucking, get a safety pin and give yourself an eraser burn or something, you know? Like, there are a lot of things going on.
What did we stumble? What did we stumble across here?
I already know what would make Anthony cry now.
Really?
So I don't,
yeah. Why don't you just let it out?
I got a little, because it's gay.
Because if you let it out, it's all going to come out.
It's fruity.
It's all going to come out.
It's all going to come, what? That I'll sit there.
I don't think it's gay to cry, as long as you're not crying all the time. I don't think you should be crying every week.
I used up all my crying as a kid.
Every once in a while, I don't think there's anything wrong with
it. I cried all the time. At the drop of a hat, I cried as a kid. I was being asked this weekend, what did you cry at? I just told my girlfriend, I was like, everything. I cried at everything.
But that's
and I
good.
Showed her a clip of me on Christmas morning playing the little drums. I was like 3 years old. I'm playing little drums, and my brother's playing the guitar. And the drums kept sliding forward when I hit the little kick pedal.
Mm-hmm.
And I was just psh, 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 making noise. And you see me on the film just going, it's not moving.
I cried when I was three.
Yeah, well, that's pretty gay.
A three-year-old
fucking
crying?
Game.
My God. I don't get it. I honestly just don't get it.
What do you not get?
I cried so much as a kid. Yeah.
Well, see, that's
What's different about that? All kids do that.
But that's he's repeating what he heard as a kid.
Oh, yeah.
You cry so much as a kid. You cry too much as a kid.
Oh, yeah. I'm sure, yeah, it's typical. It's just his parents didn't want to deal with it.
Mm-hmm. And parents, because when parents see their kids crying, a lot of times they get emotional about it. They don't know how to deal with the emotions they're feeling about it. And so they tell their kid to stop it.
Yeah.
So that they don't have to deal with it.
Yeah. And dad specifically, you know, the stop crying will give you something to cry about. Call him names. Call him slurs because he cries so much.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's the only reason he feels the way he does as an adult.
Yeah.
Because of how shitty his fucking parents dealt with it when he was a kid.
Mm-hmm. And he's doing nothing to try to heal that because he doesn't think there's anything to heal.
No, and unfortunately, in this environment, we don't get pushback on how shitty his dad is ever. Like, no one ever talks about that. Everyone just joins in with Anthony agreeing.
Yeah.
Like, oh, yeah, you cried a lot.
Yeah, and then Opie being like, oh, I mean, I don't think it's gay to cry as long as you're not crying too much. Like, once a week? Oh! Like,
what?
I genuinely feel like crying is an emotional orgasm.
Yeah, I can see that.
Because you allow your emotions to come to such a head in your body that they come out physically.
Yeah.
That is so good for you.
Yeah.
Just like orgasming is good for people. Because there's energy that you're like, that is always in you. Emotions are always existing, no matter how much you ignore them. And then if you let them, whether it be happy tears, sad tears, angry tears, tears can come out in all sorts of kinds of things, like from rooted in different kinds of emotions. And to let yourself be so fully immersed in the feeling that it comes to a head and you're like, oh my God, I'm crying about this. That's beautiful. That's fucking awesome. And like to deny yourself, because that's all you're doing. You're denying yourself that.
Yeah.
No one's going to gain anything from you not crying.
Yeah.
Like what? You're just, it's like saying, oh, I'm not going to eat. My body feels hungry, but I'm not going to eat because like eating is weak. Gay. Eating's for the weak. Eating's gay. And it's just like, nobody's gaining anything from you not eating.
Right.
Like, unless you're in some like weird specific situation where you're like locked in a room with somebody with like one sandwich and you have to survive. Like no one's gaining anything from you being emotionally like stunted.
Bobby asking Ant, are you afraid if you were to cry, it would all come out, is very telling. And they don't spend nearly enough time on it, because I don't think anybody else heard it.
Yeah.
But that's a very good question.
Well, see, that's why I argue I know what would make him cry.
Mm.
It's what would make many people cry. And it's not some stereotypical like, oh, you know, somebody dying and this and this. It's meeting somebody where they are and acknowledging them, validating them, and reassuring them that they're not alone and that they're still loved. Being compassionate to somebody is such an easy way to make them cry.
Yeah.
Especially when they don't expect it.
Oh, yeah.
Because even though Anthony has made so many shitty choices and everything,
yeah,
I still think he deserves compassion at where he is. Mm. And compassion isn't just saying that, oh, I everything you've done, it's okay. Because it's not okay.
Yeah.
Compassion would be, I get where you're coming from. I get where this comes from.
Mm-hmm.
Because it all starts somewhere, in my opinion. It's all taught to some degree.
Yeah.
No one's born a bigot. No one's born a shitty person. No one's born a shitty kid. They all learn all of these things from people who did not do the work to unpack the issues that they're experiencing and that they're projecting onto the world.
Right.
So, like, when you, especially when someone is being their shittiest, when you can approach them and say, I understand where this comes from. I hear what you're saying. You're not saying you agree with it or that you think it's okay, but you can see them.
Mm.
And because a lot of times these hyper bigoted, like, word vomit is just like a smokescreen to cover up the fact that they're afraid.
Yeah.
And it's like, I hear that you're afraid right now. And like, I respect that. I respect that you're afraid, that it's okay to be afraid, because what they want to hear is that it's okay that they have been heard, that they have been seen, like deep, deep down.
Yeah.
And then when you touch that part of somebody, it turns into a, well, what the fuck do I say with this? What do I fucking, and it's almost like an aspect of de-escalation by reaching someone past the point that they want you to.
Yeah.
By touching them somewhere that is beyond their guard so that they don't know what to do.
Do you think that's why someone like Anthony is so against therapy? Because he worries that would do that?
Well, therapy implies that you're willing to open up to some degree to somebody.
Right.
Voluntary therapy means you're willing to open up in some way, shape, or form.
Mm-hmm.
Even if you never actually open up, the fact that you sought therapy holds that meaning.
Yeah.
And a lot of times it can mean that someone's going to therapy and they want the person to open them up. Give me a reason to trust you.
Yeah.
I do not trust anybody. Give me a reason to trust you. Build that trust for me. And that therapy is a great way for people who've experienced trauma to learn that it's okay to feel safe with people.
Mm.
'Cause I don't think that Anthony feels safe with anybody.
Yeah, probably. It probably feels on guard. Like, it's very telling. He says specifically in that clip we just listened to that Jill asked Anthony what he used to cry at. The only reason that would have come up is because she noticed that he has a hard time doing it as an adult.
Yeah.
I want to hear what that discussion was like, why she asked him that, because that's a very weird thing to just randomly come up in conversation.
Yeah.
There has to have been a reason.
Maybe they were watching a movie, and she was tearing up, and...
And couldn't understand why...
Like, why... What, you don't feel anything about this part? You know, like...
We actually got a comment on our last episode that I wanted to read, because it's relevant here. I feel like y'all would be the best friends to have for Anthony, if only because you'd actually call him out on his bullshit, and you'd also have the receipts for all the dumb things he said in the past. And I wrote back and said, I think that's what we're doing. It's not like we'd be able to do it on Twitter. He's done a great job of building up very tall walls around himself. Yeah. A safe space, if you will.
Yeah.
And then he responds, they respond... I wonder if their egos would be big enough to actually watch an episode. And I, no. For one, our episodes are too long.
Yeah.
They would not sit down and watch our episodes, for one. No, absolutely not at all.
Mm-hmm.
But, no, I don't think they'd give a shit what two randos on YouTube have
to
say about
them. Two random queers on YouTube.
They're not going to give us the time of day at all. No, not at all. But to say, I feel like y'all would be the best friends to have for Anthony... I do think he needs people like us, though.
I think everybody needs people, like, not necessarily like us, because I don't want to seem too conceited about that.
People who are doing something similar to what we're doing.
Yeah, I think it's a mixture of accountability, because within the like framework of compassion, accountability exists. Like, you have to be able to be like, yeah, you said this shit, like, let's talk about that.
I think that's why Patrice was so valuable.
Yeah.
Because he would be the kind of person who would hold Anthony accountable to things he said.
Yeah.
And be like, wow, that's really racist, dude. Mm-hmm. And still meet him where he was by making it a bit.
Exactly.
Laughing about it. Making it comfortable for Anthony to deal with. Once Patrice died, I think that's the beginning of the end.
What, so I wonder if there's any kind of fallout that can be seen around the time Patrice died.
See, we're already so ingrained or so deep into the... We're trying to go down the figuring out how things change around the election. That's why we're in 2008. Because the belief up to this point has been that Obama being elected is what sends Anthony into a spiral.
Mm-hmm.
I am curious, though, how much worse it gets.
Yeah.
When Patrice passes away.
Yeah.
Should we jump around?
Yeah, it'd be fine jumping around.
Jump around to maybe the episodes right after that, see what that's
maybe
like.
Maybe before and after, so I can sense, like, a tonal shift.
That's not a bad idea.
Because, like, if you think about the way that humans do, how humans feel, like... You know, oh, having a good time, having a good time. Oh my God, I just found out that one of my besties just died. And you're just like, like, you can feel the difference. And like when somebody shows up to work after a day of like, oh yeah, we're having such a good time. Yeah, let's continue that conversation. They're just like, yeah, hey. Yeah. And you're just like, did something happen?
Yeah.
You know?
So fast forwarding to the next day.
Are they still talking about Peter Wentz?
Not talking about Peter Wentz anymore, but this is a follow-up.
A follow-up boy?
The fans took Jimmy at his word. They heard his call.
Oh no, his call to action.
They descended upon this blogger after Jim gave out his email address. And they came upon this guy very hard. And
they came upon this guy very hard. Okay.
So this is how Jim reacts to it the next day.
It was an NBC blog. They had mentioned a bunch of celebrities, quote unquote, that were at the UFC fight.
Mm-hmm.
And they had mentioned Jim Norton. And in parentheses, it's like, he's a comedian. Does he count? I'll let you decide. So I was a little insulted, being a baby and a comedian with no sense of humor.
Considering all the work you're putting into your career, you're a bit...
No, but it's just amazing how I try to throw atomic bombs at people, and somebody jokingly throws a jab at me, and I just cry like a bitch. I just have my face slapped. So I got, Danny just gave me an email from Mike Chiappetta, who's the guy. It says, I'm the douche blogger that supposedly insulted Jim Norton. I should have known better. than using a throwaway line on an O&A personality. Since I've listened to the show, since you guys came on to New York on NEW, Jay Moore was drawing maps of Hawaii, and you guys hosted the short-lived NFL pregame show. Anyways, meant
XFL.
No dis-
I wish it was the
NFL would have been nice. You
know. Short-lived, yeah, my fault.
It was the failed one.
No, but what that was called, by the way, that mistake was called so anxious to get back to my part, I just skipped everything else.
Yes, you selfish little man.
And now we have a new problem.
What, sweetie?
The problem is he had to mention the XFL thing, so now Ant and I have a problem with this guy.
Hey, yeah.
He didn't have to do that.
And you guys hosted the short-lived XFL pregame show. Anyway, no disrespect to Jim. It was a three-second throwaway line in between matches. But I just added another paragraph onto the original story to correct my mistake that reads, note, the emails are in, the people have spoken, and Jim Norton counts. For whatever it's worth, I listened to O&A going back to NEW, watched Lucky Louie, and have seen Norton stand up. No disrespect intended, just wondering if most of mainstream America knew who he was. Turns out I'm the idiot. I'm probably inviting more trouble by sending this email, but you guys have made me laugh enough times in life that I wanted you to know that you've definitely got my respect. Sorry, Jim. Regards, Mike.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. Okay,
thanks,
wow.
Mike.
A bit embarrassing.
Just a little bit.
Maybe I could have sent a small email directly to you and saying, hey, my feelings were a little hurt by that.
I was a little miffed.
And we could have had a discussion about this instead of me just sending the fucking pests after you. Just knowing how when they send the fans after other radio shows, how their Facebook pages would usually have to be, like, made private because their Facebook walls would be covered with, like, porn pictures and horrible death pictures, and he probably got a good bit of those.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I can't blame him too much. I do understand his, like, I should have known better than to, especially someone who's so well known that he's making references to the show from their fucking late 90s, and for him to, like, maybe you should have made a note that, you know, you could have made a little joke about, like, O&A's third mic, Jim, but, like, to say Jim Norton, if you know who he is, maybe you should have made some joke, but, like, I'm not trying to blame him for this.
Right.
He didn't deserve the attack he got.
Right.
But he probably should have known better to some degree.
Hey, if he's a fan, he deserves it. I'm just kidding.
Yeah, I mean, if you understand and you know the O&A audience, that he probably didn't mind so much. He's probably like, oh, yeah, this does make sense.
You're like, oh, damn. Literally, as I was saying, a throwaway line.
Yeah.
Such and a...
You knew it. You fucking called it. But that brings us to the end of this week's episode. It's very funny. I said, hey, this is probably going to be a shorter episode, and we still recorded for 2 hours anyway.
Hey, okay.
That's just how it always goes.
That's okay.
I don't know how long the episode itself will be, but yeah, at the recording right now, it's at... 1 hour, 59.5 minutes. So, yeah, I guess that's a decent enough amount of material. I have to remember that.
Yeah.
Well, especially, I think the emo discussion, I knew that once they talked about Pete Wentz that would give us
stuff to
talk
about. And
then
you give me permission to talk about emo?
Because I knew the Joe Horn thing would probably be the discussion up front, but we didn't really have as too much to say about it because, you know, it's a fucking news story from 2007.
Yeah.
And, you know, what's there to really say? I don't really have much of a stance on stand your ground states and self-defense laws.
Yeah.
It's not exactly stuff I preoccupy myself with.
Mm-hmm.
But thank you so much for spending your time and listening to our show this week. Make sure you're following us on Spotify so you don't miss the next episode. And we will see you next time on O&A Detox. But until then...